flowers?
Yes.
We'll individually take the flowers.
Narayan, to introduce our distinguished panelists and begin our discussion. Thank you.
Thank you.
Dr. Hegde did remind us of one thing. Today's world is full of noise pollution. So I'll try to reduce the noise pollution as much as possible by sticking to time, number one. Number two, in allowing people to talk little less because of the time constraint. More could be discussed during a lunch break where we can have one-to-one or one-on-one discussions. And I would request everyone who has got a mobile phone with them or a smartphone with them to put it on silence mode so that it doesn't disturb the audience. Discussion now. And the topic happens to be, is the complementary and alternate medicine, its rise and its impact on our health. And if I can use the abbreviation CAM, if I'm permitted to use so, I would define CAM as complementary and alternate medicine because most of the abbreviations have more than one meaning and therefore it becomes difficult. CAM also refers to certain other things as well. Therefore, we would stick to complementary and alternate medicine. And I have illuminaries who would be talking on different aspects of it in the panel. To my left, I have Dr. Salila Tiwari, a well-noted radio and TV figure. All of you would have seen her. She also runs the Yoga Shakti Ashram, and she has an institute of naturopathy retreat in Uttaranchal in the Himalayas. And she's been the author of The Health for 100 Years. As it is generally said, Shatamanam Bhavati, Shatayur Bhavati. I think she's one who's trying to aim at 100, though according to her Shastras, it's supposed to be 120. We'll find out from her where she missed that 20. And then we have Dr. N.K. Sharma with us. He is a world-renowned Reiki grandmaster and naturopath. And he had established hospitals, the Natural Health Institute at Mumbai, and Natural Cancer Research Foundation, New Delhi. He has lots of laurels with him. I think the more we listen to him, we would come to know of him. To my right, I have Dr. Pratap Chauhan. He is a renowned name in the field of Ayurveda, a pioneer of the ancient Indian system of medicine in bringing healing to masses. Dr. Pratap is the first one to have started an online Ayurvedic consultation and pharmacy, and today it's well known, and he's been able to give consultation. He has an Ayurvedic center where you have more than 150 Ayurvedic physicians under one roof trying to help and service people. We have Mr. Subodh Tiwari with us. He happens to be a person from the first established yoga institute, Kaivalya Dham, in Pune. And I came to know of him through my friend and classmate, happens to be the vice chancellor of the Balaji Vidyapeeth, which has two medical colleges under them. One is the Satya Sai Medical College in Chennai, the other one is Mahatma Gandhi Medical College and Research Institute in Pondicherry. And recently, I think about 2 months back, they have got into the so-called memorandum of misunderstanding. And we have a very good establishment there. And I'm happy that Dr. Subodh is also there with us. And then we have Dr. Yeah, Dr. R.K. Thule. Thule is a graduate from Armed Forces Medical College. Therefore, I have somebody to control us here, disciplinarian. And he's been into a lot of things. Probably, normally we say that people cannot sell coal into the castles, but he had intruded into China and he's also done his job very well there. And he's been a very good pranic healer, a hypnotherapist, a nutrition expert, a lifestyle expert. There are many more things that are there with him. But what we would have is probably he's the one who had established a center in Apollo Indraprastha Hospital. And that is a credit that he has for the holistic medicine. So these are the people who are going to be there with us. And we would have a little bit of discussion on this. Keeping in mind the time factor, I think it's important that we need to restrict ourselves in the discussion. Though a lot of introduction had been done by Dr. Hegde, we'll continue the discussion now. All that is important. Yeah, we'll always do that. Lunch can always be cut down. Because in Tamil, there is a saying written by the saint poet Thiruvalluvar. Sevikunavu illada pozhudhu sirudhu vayitrukkum iyappadum. The transliteration of it, if you do not have food for your ears, something would be given to your stomach. And we would stick to that. Complementary alternate medicine, as it is named by somebody else, becomes a little difficult. As far as we are concerned, I think it's a holistic medicine. This takes into consideration the body, mind and the spirit, because all three coexist in harmony. And when there is a harmony between the body, mind and the spirit, you are considered to be healthy. And if that be so, we have different aspects that are being looked into today, because we have fragmentation as on now. And let's try to see how the so-called CAM helps in maintaining our health and how could it sustain. One aspect of it was possibly yoga. And yoga is something which is very important. And let's listen from Mr. Tiwari as to how yoga has an impact on our current health. Let's try to be in the capsule form. We can sit down and then we can.
In these 10 minutes, I'll take you through this topic wherein I would tell you something about the place where I come from, necessarily because that is the place where scientific research in the field of yoga started in the year 1924. It's the first institute to look at, investigate yoga in a scientific manner. And then come to the aspect of yoga therapy, because my subject, I'll confine it to yoga from the CAM. There are experts from other fields who will naturally go into the other aspects of specialties. All of us, you know, we know yoga is an experiential subject. And therefore, some of it could be understood by the philosophical and theoretical understanding, but practice forms the most important aspect. I remember recently I was in the Bihar School of Yoga and I was told about one story by Swami Niranjan. He says one of his students was traveling from the US back to Calcutta and he had a scientist sitting beside him who had been awarded a PhD on the recipe and interpretation of it. Finally, the yoga sadhak asked the scientist, now why are you going to Calcutta for? He says, well, I've got my PhD on that subject, now I'm going to taste it. So sometimes that happens in life. Well, I come from the institute where you see the founder, Swami Kuvalanand, who founded it in 1906 1917 and then established it at Lonavala 1924. I'll just browse through these quickly. This is the present structure where his disciple and my father Tiwariji is right now the senior most master. Swami Maheshananji is our spiritual guide and Shri Krishnaji is the chairman of board of advisors. When I said that this was this place where scientific research started, we work in a very structured form where we evolve a methodology by first understanding yoga. So there are two important components. One is the understanding of the subject in depth and then trying to interpret it in a scientific manner. So the philosophy department looks at the texts in depth and the scientific research department interprets the texts. We educate people in that sphere through what we have found through the college and apply the knowledge through the hospital, which happened to be the first ever hospital dedicated to yoga therapy, started in 1961 with 100 beds. While Dr. Hegde was speaking about the aspects of the need to maintain records and need to ensure that scientific evidence is collected, the research in Kevaldham started in 1924 and therefore also the application of yoga as a therapy started in the same year. There were articles published in a research journal called Yoga Mimamsa, which at that point of time, whatever methodology was available for investigation that was used, and then very systematically and scientifically Swamiji and his colleagues implemented yoga as now what we call it as complementary or an alternative therapy. And we have been we have a lot of records based on the applications we have made. Essentially, as far as yoga is concerned, we can consider its application in three ways. One is, there are some situations where it can completely be an alternative therapy. We have patients, we have people being sent by medical fraternity. So not all are who want patients to be under their surveillance and earn money all the time, but we have people who are recommended for issues which can be taken care of completely by yoga and allied therapies. There are people who come in for to apply it as a complementary therapy because they feel that while they are going through the conventional treatment, they are much better off if they include the alternative therapies and yoga. And of course, we have a lot of people also coming post-intervention, like in cancer, in other issues where people would come later to rejuvenate and enhance their systems. When we speak of yoga as a therapeutic application, mostly nowadays what we see and we get worried about is only the partial approach to understanding and application of yoga and compartmentalizing it too much. You know, this set is good for diabetes, this set is good for asthma, this set is good for hypertension. Well, four important principles which govern yoga as therapy and which also say it loud that it's a holistic science, four dimensions to it. The first is the aspect of mind and psychology. That is what yoga is about. When you read the Sutra of Patanjali, which says yogena chittasya padena vacham, it is the chitta aspect which has been emphasized. The second, of course, is the physiological aspect. The third is the importance of detoxification. And fourth is the great importance laid to the diet and the behavioral aspect into yoga. So when we look at application of yoga as an intervention, we should remember that these are four important aspects which you should consider. The first one which we said related to your mind, and like it was mentioned in the morning, this was an experiment conducted in Kavaldham some 35 years ago, where in fact we are trying to establish the effect of your mind on that part of the involuntary nervous system, where it said that mind has great influence over your system. So if, like this, we said life positive, it should be positive, not negative. Positivity has its own effects. So this was an experiment conducted by making someone agitated and see its effect on his stomach. The lining changed, and then when he was normalized through relaxation, you could see it returning back. So just an indicator to the application of yoga and the importance of its mind-body interrelation, correlation. These are principles which govern it. I will be fast on these slides because we don't have enough time. But like I said, that when we speak of complementary alternative therapies, if we speak of yoga, the principles of yoga should be kept in mind. Those are some of the important aspects which govern the intervention. So when we speak of asanas or the physical intervention of yoga asanas, we should remember the principles through which it is to be practiced. Here we just did an experiment of how it is when it is done in a way where Patanjali says sthir sukham asanam prayatna shaithilya ananta samapati abhyam, and here there is when you do it strenuously and the kind of impact it has on you. Of course, these were experiments which were conducted on effects of these intricate practices of yoga, which nowadays are not very popular because of many reasons, but very effective and very integrated to yoga, these bands and mudras. And a lot of work has been done on this. Coming to the probably the last discussion I would have is, there has been, of course, a great rise in yoga being taken up as a therapeutic intervention. If we try to look at the alternative systems in India, we have a ministry of Ayush, so we recognize the system of Ayurveda, yoga, Unani, Siddha, yoga and naturopathy and homeopathy, and now they've also incorporated the Tibetan medicine into the system of Ayush. And the advantage we have is, at least with yoga, I see a lot of a large amount of research being done, and we have a lot of evidence-based research. Now, what also happens with that is that the rationalistic understanding of its effects get more clarity to people who are practicing it. That is the way we see it. Yoga as an application towards therapy, of course, there is no medicine involved. It is much safer, much economical. And today, when, of course, you have, I think the large amount of papers coming out internationally, published for yoga research, even not only in India but throughout the world, have also given it a wide opening for acceptability in the hardcore allopathic system or the modern medicine or the hospitals, which in fact are the first places where people go through. So you have large number of the OPDs in yoga being opened up. In Bombay Municipal Corporation has decided that all its hospitals will have a center for holistic healing, which is a very good thing to enter with. You can start with yoga, but you have many other aspects coming in slowly. The Maharashtra University of Health Sciences has included 36 hours of yoga education for all their graduates. Right now, it just started, and at least we have been conducting a lot of continuing medical education programs for the medical fraternity to educate them about yoga, its relevance, its scientific implications, implementation. And of course, the easiest part is it can be practiced by most of the people without any problems, because there is no intake of any kind of medicine. So this is an overview of yoga. We could have said much more, but I'll confine myself right now here. And if we go on for any kind of discussions, I had presentations, a lot of research which has been done, but that probably at some later point of time. Thank you so much.
It's been a wonderful thing. Right in the beginning, I think he had made it very clear that this has to be experiential. So unless you go through the process, you will not be able to understand. And it again brings in, to my mind, the age-old Chinese proverb. Well, that's the way how they put it across. But then I think it's been the Indian. You hear, you forget. You see, you remember. You do, you understand. Therefore, I think, unless you do it yourself, you may not be able to. And that's possibly one thing that probably has come up, the rising of the so-called complementary and alternate medicine. He also very clearly pointed out a few things. If I could refer to what Dr. Hegde said in the morning, most of the asanas that we use in yoga, or the postures as it is being put across to the Yankees or the Westerners, okay? All of them have their names derived only from the birds and the animals. Dr. Hegde said, it's only the human being, the so-called highly evolved animal, which has all the diseases. To get rid of the diseases, you need to get back to the lower animal kingdom. And all these asanas are the postures, whether it is Kukudasana or Mayurasana, things like that, it brings you to that particular posture or position so that you take care of your health. I mean, that's a gentle reminder that comes from yoga. And also he rightly pointed out, a guy who had got his PhD in the intricacies of Rasgulla finally had to go down to Kolkata to taste it. And therefore it's important, unless you go through this, you may not be able to understand things. So to that extent, I think the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare had recognized this. They have brought in the so-called complementary and alternate medicine into this mainstream of medicine, the modern medicine, if I could use that. All these words I use within quotes because though I am an allopath, I agree to disagree on many things. And these are the things which are very important because these are ancient systems. What had stood the test of time for over 5,000 years, a system that has come into existence about 500 years back, tries to question it, tries to say that you need to have evidence-based medicine. When it had stood the test of time for years, what more evidence is needed? That's a point for us to remember and contemplate upon. Thank you, Tiwari, for having enlightened us on this. Though we talk of yoga or postures, it's also important for us to realize that there is something that is available in nature which helps us to heal ourselves and to be normal human being, or a healthy adult, if you could put across. And that takes us to the cure of a self by nature. And that possibly you call it as naturopathy. I mean, you need to give some names or christening that is needed for something. And there's a name that's been given again by the Westerners. But the Indian system of the Sanatana Dharma, if you could put across, or the ancient wise people had probably called it in a different way. Shall we hear a little more on this from Dr. Salila?
It is our misfortune that since 38 years I have been crying, shouting. Even Gandhiji always said that after independence my next target will be, for a poor country like India, nature cure is the best. Because we just use air, water, sunlight, and mud, and akash. That's all. And food made of these things can cure everything. And he says that from 1,000 diseases by nature cure, you can take care of 999. So he was so much dedicated to it, he experimented on his life, and unfortunately, all this government, they come and take the oath in Rajghat, and but nobody has fulfilled his wishes. He always said that villages where there is no medical facility, nature cure should be propagated. So I have been also, there's an organization, International Naturopathy Organization, vice president of it. I've been trying, going to doctors, I'm going to people, going to doctors, government, please recognize this is a very good thing, very good thing. But now, after so many years, I understood there is no point going to the government. Now I will go approach directly to public. And the way it was said, you eat the rasgulla. So I teach everybody, be your own doctor. And my movement is Swasth Bachao Andolan. I just invite everybody, you become member in 100 rupees life membership, and we teach you everything. And in that, they have to taste it. Every day the homework will be, do this, do this. But what is that? I believe that every pathy is incomplete without naturopathy. Because the pathy has been given the name. Because some pathy, as Dr. Ananta Narayan said. But naturopathy is healthy way of living. First of all, everybody should understand that no medicine can cure our immunity cures. Our immunity is very important. And how to boost and how to keep the immunity strong. That is why in our sciences, there are two kinds of sciences. Health sciences and disease sciences. Health sciences are nature cure, yoga, wherever health has been in detail given that how to maintain good health. If the health is there, no disease will ever come to you. And disease is dis-ease, body is not at ease. Why? Because you are away from nature and there is no health. So you have to bring the health and then only the disease will go. So allopathy is completely disease science. They will never tell you what to eat, what to take, and in our pathy, how to breathe, when to sleep, how to get up, what to eat, everything in detail we tell. And I have found in my life, I tell everybody, throw all the medicines. People used to tell me, now I have become a little wiser, tell everybody, throw all the medicines and come to me. And I never claim that I cure, because nature cures. I have not the capacity to cure anybody. And you all have that capacity in your body, that supreme healing power is there in your body. And just by introducing few tips, they recover. Because nature cure believes that body has been created by nature. No scientist, no doctor can create this supreme and the perfect creation of this universe, human body. Within 9 months, the body is created. You don't need anybody. All the details of the body will be created. That is created by nature. After the birth, from the first breath to last breath, you keep on breathing. Nobody knows who is managing. And it never happens that whenever there is trouble, the body tells you. In the same way, you are eating the food, you drink the water, you digest it, you don't know. So many mechanisms is taking place. And how wonderfully, if you are astic, you can say Paramatma, or you can say some problem, and you are very tired, and you go to sleep by night, and in the morning you get up, and you will see your tiredness is gone. If there is a fracture, you go to the doctor, doctor just sets it. And there is a cut, the doctor will put the stitches. But ultimately, nature cures. The biggest healer is the doctor within. That we say immunity, vital force, vitality, that is the principle of basic principle of nature cure.
And fourth is always sarva bhuta hite rata. Nature always working for the welfare and the mangal and the kalyan of this whole universe. That is what is happening in our body. Every cell is working. He can explain in a very scientific language because he is a different kind of person. I know my subject, and he can throw the shot put. He can throw the javelin. He will go back also. He will come front also. I don't have that, of course. Whatever I know, I will tell you. So your body has all the power. But nowadays, we ask everybody, when a body is created by God and it is managed by God and it is always, healer is within you and he is always working in the welfare of you, then why the hell there should be a disease? That's the question. But everybody is suffering. Everybody is sick. Why? Because we know how to operate plane, computers, so many things, but we do not know what all God or nature requires to maintain and sustain this body. This body, as in the Yat Pinde Tat Brahmande, in outside you will see three functions are taking place: creation, preservation, destruction. Same thing is happening in our body in three forms. You eat the food, you drink the water, or you breathe, whatever goes inside. First it digests, then it is assimilated, and then it is eliminated. So these functions, if are done properly, there will not be any problem. But when problem arises, we do not know what all this body requires. People come to me, the basic knowledge nobody gives, that how much water you should drink. This body is made up of five elements, and 70% of our body is water. And when we drink less water, I have so many international patients, they ask me by telephone that we have a blood pressure, whatever you told us, our blood pressure is not going down. And I tell them how much water you have taken. No, plenty. No, you count it. I tell them that through urine, stool, perspiration, respiration, we throw 2.5 to 3 liters of water. If you are not compensating that much of water, your blood will be toxic. It can't circulate. You will have headaches. You will have joint pain. You will have blockages in your heart. You may have stone in the kidney or gallbladder. So many problems will take place just by not taking proper water. So what to speak of all these things if you do not know how much water you should take? So that is what nature causes. So I believe any science, whether it is homeopathy, Ayurveda, of course, is 100% naturopathy, because naturopathy remembers 100% whatever Ayurveda says. And also Hippocrates used to say, nature cures, not the physician. That is what is our principle also, that immunity your nature cures, not the physician. And the second thing he used to say, give me fever and I will burn all the diseases. He never considered fever is bad. And there's so many things he used to say, Hippocrates, we are following that. And the same way, the only difference between Ayurveda, which is practiced nowadays, the modern Ayurveda, of course, and difference between nature cure is, nature cure believes what Hippocrates used to say, make food thy medicine thy food. No need of taking any medicine. If you are not taking proper water, you have to take the water first. So we teach everybody, there are 10 points to maintain good health. And those 10 points are, this body is made up of 5 elements: air, water, fire, ether, earth. You have to provide, that is our science says, how much, when, where, and your body will be okay perfectly. And then 5 more things: healthy food, then exercise, then rest, then cleanliness, and then positive thinking. These 10 points we teach everybody, train everybody. And now in my movement, so many students, so many people have joined, and I am not claiming any way that I cure. Hepatitis, cancer patients, blood pressure within 10 days goes away. And so many miracles are happening. People say this is miraculous. No, Nature always requires, if suppose the grass is not getting enough sunlight, it will dry up. And I just put the water and I claim that I took care of this grass. No. Body has all the capacity. You have to understand scientifically what all is required. Of course, Nature Cure has very powerful instrument, that is yoga. Yoga is very powerful, and we also add, because we have five bodies, the holistic approach in Nature Cure is that we believe in yoga therapy completely, because it's drugless. Any drugless therapy is all Nature Cure. So we include yoga also. So yoga says five bodies: Annamaya Kosh, Pranamaya Kosh, Jnanamaya Kosh, Vijnanamaya Kosh, Anandamaya Kosh. All these five bodies should be taken into consideration. And with that, we provide proper scientific nutrition and we cure everything. Of course, yoga, Nature Cure, and for the emergencies, we teach in my movement also acupressure. Because people come here and people say that for emergency you have to go to allopathy. So if we tell them that, oh no, then you have to go now. So that is why we teach everybody acupressure. But I found recently, just by putting few points of color, and you can take care of your blood pressure and so many things, that is Sujog therapy. The Professor Park Jewu, he taught us, it's an advanced, I should say, it's a supreme thing given by him, our guru, Professor Park Jewu. And that is so powerful. And we teach everybody, all the ladies, all the gents, all the students, we teach basic requirement of Nature Cure, how to live healthy, and then yoga, complementing it with that, and with that acupressure, Sujog, and little bit of magnet therapy to take care of your body. And I have never found any failure. Because, of course, healthy way of living, you are not following and you have problem. You start following and gradually your immunity will start recovering and will stop complaining and your body will be at ease. And the second thing, Nature Cure believes, as all the Indian therapy believes, they do not believe in bacteria infection. That is the greatest hoa, we all know, of this modern days. We believe that accumulation of waste matter in the body, that garbage is the food of all the bacteria. That is why no need of taking any medicine, just detoxify your body, clean your system. That is why in Ayurveda we have Panchakarma of how to detoxify within. I tell all my students, you have wear your clothes every day washed, you take your bath every day, and then you wash your hair regularly, you clean your mop your floor, everything. And you clean your tiles, and with you have Harpic to flush also you clean. But do not know how much garbage your body is accumulating. Just clean it. That's what our rishis, all our scientists used to say. Panchakarma. And yoga has Shatakarma even further. Six ways. They have added Kapalabhati. It's such a powerful detoxification process. And with that we use detoxification, and Nature Cure believes in five elements. Every Ayurvedic medicine is made up of five elements. And all the nutrition you get in any food is because of your five elements. So that is why the color, the nutrition, everything you derive is because of the five elements. And our pathy says the how this world was created. And in that it is described that how the formless, the nirguna nirakara Brahma created this universe, just by in a form, different form and different rupa, rasa, gandha, how he created. He created akash tattva from his body. And that is one guna, that is called shabda. You can listen, that one sense organ is created. And after that, air. Air is two guna, that is sense of sparsha. And in this way, these five elements are the divine elements created out of this nirakara, nirguna. That is why these five elements are divine for us, and we use these five elements scientifically and detoxify the body. We don't give any medicine, and patients come to us with such a big list of medicines. When they are thrown into dustbin, they come to us. And I always tell them, throw the medicine and come to me. and so many patients, they are worried how to, my medicines are very expensive and they are worried. I heard Dr. Hegde and so many people, the truth is self-expressive. It just requires some media and it will keep on expressing. When yada yadai dharma se glanir me vati bhavad. See, dharma is there and it will come again and again. But why I am wondering, this divine faith in allopathy, we could not shake. What to do? That's why I started the movement. People are so much afraid to give up medicines. Oh, how can medicine... one more thing I have to tell you. This allopathy is 100-year-old science. That also has experimented on guinea pigs. Mental level, nobody knows. What changes take place in... what to speak of mental and spiritual and different thing. And now only chemicals. Hippocrates used to say, make food, no food. You'd ask any doctor, what food we should... you eat anything. Ab goli khao. Phir iske baad do goli khao, teen goli khao. I tell everybody, suppose somebody has a big loss in his business, 1 crore, 10 crore, and he'll be depressed, he won't feel any appetite is there, and the depression is there, some friend will suggest, take a dose of whiskey, and you will get good sleep, and good appetite also. And they start, after that, some time, he'll start getting good sleep, and also good appetite. After them, problem is not touched. Problem is always there. The losses. The medicine never touches your losses. And that is why you go to that friend, now again I am getting the same problem. And they will advise you, take the 2 classes or maybe 3 times a day, morning, evening, afternoon. And this way they are making everybody addicted to allopathy medicines. And people are so much addicted. It is very difficult for me, and that is why I started this movement, and I invite everybody, join my hands. It is so simple. I have never, whatever I am talking to you, it is through my conviction. I have never given any vaccination to my children, grandchildren. I never give any medicine to them, and they are so healthy, fit and fine, because my vaccination is nutritious diet. My vaccination is breathing exercise. My nutrition is your proper rest and clean system and positive thinking. Not this bullshit which we have been taught. And I fail to understand how to... this 100-year-old science, this experimental science, and they also experiment only on third world country like us. Because hamara suraj jo hai, वो सूर्य पश्चिम में उगता है, पूर्व में उगना बंद हो गया. क्या करें? 5000 ईयर ओल्ड साइंस जो है, उसके पर हमारा फेथ नहीं है. हमारा अभी ये क्वेश्चन उठ रहा है कि डू वी रिक्वायर. ये क्वेश्चन कहां से आया? दिस इज नॉट कॉम्प्लीमेंट्री, दिस इज द ओरिजिनल. राइजिंग इज एलोपैथी, दिस इज नॉट राइजिंग ऑफ कॉम्प्लीमेंट्री, दिस इज द ओरिजिनल थेरेपी. पीपल फ्रॉम नेचर क्योर इज, जब से नेचर बना है तब से लोग जो है मिट्टी पानी धूप हवा कर रहे हैं, मसाज कर रहे हैं, दबा रहे हैं, डिटॉक्सिफिकेशन कर रहे हैं. दिस नथिंग न्यू, दिस साइंस इज जस्ट राइजिंग, इज राइजन सिंस हम लोग जब से गुलाम हुए हैं. और ये मेंटेलिटी हमारी गुलामी की बड़ा मुश्किल हो गया है, डीप रूटेड हो गई है. और ऐसे बड़े बड़े ज्ञानी लोग आकर के भी हिला नहीं पा रहे हैं. इसीलिए हमारा मेंबर बनिए, वी वॉन्ट टू स्प्रेड दिस ऑल ओवर दिस वर्ल्ड. And we educate everybody. It's very, very simple to be healthy. You don't require any medicine. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Salila. In a very natural way, she put across the importance of the 5 elements, the panchabhutas, and how body could take care of itself. She was very concerned that there's not rising of the complementary and alternate medicine, but that it's been the original medicine. But again, if you look into scriptures, Lord Krishna had said, Paritranaya sadhunam vinasaya chadushkritam dharma samsthapanarthaya sambhavami yuge yuge. As and when there is a need, he would come back. Probably this is one such occasion where I think the traditional and the ancient medicine has to come up. maybe this is a forum through which the good things are rising up again. So it is again rise of complementary and alternate medicine. That's the way how I would take it up.
I'm sorry, this alternate medicine I just object, but of course
they call it, that's what I said, it is somebody who had given the name. We have not given that name.
Okay.
So we try to discuss and then we try to say. Again, it's important for us to remember, she was mentioning about Harpic and things like that. I'm not very sure how many of you know, in today's way how the house is being constructed, you have your restroom where you have your bathing also, you have your wash basin, you brush your teeth. Every time you flush your toilet, you know how many germs get into your toothbrush? Many of us probably are not aware of it. It is infested and infected with the bacteria that you tend to get more diseases. In ancient system, we never had that sort of a thing. Things are totally different. I think it's important that we need to look into that. She was talking about immune busters and immune builders. How many of us know under naturopathy, our own things, even Dr. Hegde today mentioned this morning, somebody is coming out of the capsules of the so-called bullshit, improving. I think we had Shivambu therapy, the auto-urine therapy that people are mocking at when Morarji Desai talked about it. Today we know. So these are certain things possibly she has brought in. What is more important is harmonizing the five elements within our system so that you lead a happy life, a peaceful and a healthy life. There was a time when food was taken as medicines. Today is a time where medicines are taken as food. If you remember correctly, before breakfast, 5 drugs. Either before or after lunch, another 10. Evening. So this is what has become today. And therefore, it's important for us to remember as to how we would be able to harmonize things and then go ahead. She also brought in the concept of the modern computer language. Garbage in, garbage out. It's what is happening. The so-called junk food that we take today are causing more harm to the body than the natural food that is available. If I want to grow apple tree in Tamil Nadu, I think it would be very difficult for me because I don't have the conducive atmosphere, the sitoshna as they say, or the necessary things. That is one of the reasons why possibly we need to look into treating a person of a particular disease. You need to take into consideration what is locally available. Unfortunately, the Western medicine is not local. What is available here needs to be looked into, and naturopathy concentrates more on that and then tries to provide you all that is needed. Ayurveda looks into that. She also brought in the concept of mind, spirit, body, etc. So there is slowly a convergence that is occurring. We talked about yoga, we talked about naturopathy, she brought in life to it, and therefore it's important for us to understand what is prana. And today we talk of pranic healing. That's another thing that is important. And I would like to know from N.K. Sharmaji as to how the prana or the life could be sort of kept alive, hale and hearty, bubbling with joy and happiness. We call it as Reiki or the pranic healing. So how does it contribute to the modern health? How has that helped? Could you kindly tell us?
आप सभी लोगों को मेरा बहुत बहुत नमस्कार. Why I joined Reiki, I would just like to explain you a little bit. I ran my hospital, naturopathic hospital, for last 20 years. And during my hospital, I was treating especially cancer and degenerative diseases only. And it was my fireless hospital because I was not cooking any food in the hospital. I was experimenting on raw food only. during that time what I found that, what is this I am doing here? Shall I sit here and shall I wait for the patient after becoming cancerous and heart disease and diabetic, then I go, I treat him? Then I'm just wasting my time, because after 6 months again they come back. So what is that they are lacking? They are lacking knowledge. They are ignorant. So what I had to do? So I left my job, I closed my hospital, and I decided that I must train the people, I must teach the people. And as Dr. Salila Tiwari said, that they must become their own doctor and they must understand why they become sick. By that time, fortunately, I was never knowing that some subtle kind of energy also exists in this universe, like Reiki or Prana energy also. I never knew all this thing. One day, a lady came to my hospital. She did not want to exercise because she had a great boil, a big boil on her leg. So, my wife has learned Reiki, so as a naturopath, I told that, okay, go for 1 week rest and then have a light food and then do some fasting and then some mud pack and then we'll be all right. But my wife said, don't worry, just sit here, I will heal you. She was the Reiki master. So when she did Reiki, within 15 minutes, the boil reduced, the pain disappeared, and she did exercise on that day. That gave me a big shock to my mind. The problem which I could take 8 days to heal, she could just help in 15 minutes only. There must be something in this technique. So then I started working on it. And then I entered into this invisible world of this energy healing and energy medicine, whatever we call today. Then I realized, oh God, I was so close in naturopathy even. And I was not knowing that all the cause of diseases are on the invisible level rather than the visible level. Visible is the effect only. The original cause in the invisible world on the subtle level. And that subtle level is your mind. That subtle level is your soul. That subtle level is your aura, your chakra. So that, especially that particular field has very much less studied in India even. Normally, what I have found, that everything in India has been studied. Our Rishi Muni has left nothing to study. What I have felt so far, sab kuch unhone pad liya hai, sab kuch atomic last atom tak jaakar purna brahma kya kehte hain, purna vidam purna meva muchyate sab bol diya hai, they have said like this. And the science ke liye problem kya hai, how to prove that on scientific ground, that's all. Lekin we have all the knowledge. Aaj jo sparsh chikitsa atharved mein, especially they have mentioned in Atharvaveda and Yajurveda that I have given you power in your hands. Your hands are healing hands. So, then the Reiki, whatever we are using, it's a Japanese term, there is no doubt, but it is a sparsh chikitsa from our own Veda only, it is a Vedic tradition only. So that energy science, though Dr. Mikao Sui who actually discovered this technique, he also took from the India, all the literature he took from India only, via Tibet. So that energy, that science again came back to India in the form of Reiki. And when I realized that there are two kind of healing energies are existing in this universe, one is in our body, that is self-healing power, and then another is universal healing power around us, which nobody knows, and nobody is using also. So that energy, if we can tap and we can use it, then we can have a greater benefits for ourselves and the mankind also. So this healing energy, when we realized, then it was a great treasure for me. So then I established my Reiki Healing Foundation, and I started traveling and training the people into Reiki, so that, and while entering into the Reiki, what I realized that one power you have that is called self-healing power, that 24-hour your body is all the time striving, struggling to balance your, normalize and regenerate and survive economically in every condition. So body does not need much help from outside. See, the problem is allopathy, we need this allopathies because, you know, man will abuse, live abnormally by consciously or unconsciously, and then he needs certain reliefs. So therefore he is searching so many chemicals and it may be so many kinds of therapies also. So it will not disappear. Therapies kabhi duniya se jaane wali bhi nahi hai. Wo aadmi ki need hai, wo aadmi ki khosh bhi hai. Lekin aadmi ke dimag mein ye hona bahut zaruri hai ki our body is self-sufficient. As Dr. Hegde said, we really don't need much from outside actually. Aur mera ye manna hai, if suppose a medical doctor study medicine, physiology and anatomy, mujhe ye samajh mein nahi aata. When I read anatomy and physiology, what I found, you know, except God or except universal creation, I have a great appreciation. मुझे लगा कि हर आदमी को जब मेडिसिन पढ़ता है तो डॉक्टर संत महात्मा बन जाना चाहिए. क्यों? नेचर का इतना ग्रेट जो डांस है, जो नटराज है, वो देखने के बाद में ही कैनॉट बिकम एन ऑर्डिनरी डॉक्टर देन. सो हर डॉक्टर को महात्मा बनना ही चाहिए होता है. सो ये सब रियलाइज करने के बाद में देन आई स्टार्टेड यूजिंग रेकी. तो मुझे एनर्जी इनविजिबल साइंस में यह समझ में आया कि एवरीथिंग इज एनर्जी. And all energy is interchangeable. Everything influences each other. We influence each other. We influence livings. We influence non-living. So, and this, we practically experiment in our class also. We give certain positive items like crystals and fruits to a person. And then we measure the aura. The aura immediately doubles and triples. And we give them, when we give them abnormal things like Coca-Cola or something, bread or biscuit in their hands, immediately their aura goes down. So within fraction of second, the moment we hold those negative or positive things, our aura immediately changes. So it means where we sit, to whom we talk, or what kind of our house, what kind of our people around us, they are influencing ourselves. So all these things, when we started learning, then we understood that we have power to influence non-living also. Because when everything is energy, then all energy can be influenced. I have my students, shortly we are going to demonstrate them also in my big program, mega program. Through his thought power, immediately a nut bolt, he can rotate very fast just by thought power. He can bend the spoon just by watching that spoon. And even a lot of my friends like Mr. Deepak Rao in Hyderabad, He can just by sound energy, he can break the bulb. So it means the energy is so powerful that, so thought power, which we call power of intention. In our course also, we practically demonstrate that within 1 second, I ask my student to throw a thought on a person and say this intention, gir jao, fall down. And you will be surprised. When he throw his thought from there, my students start falling from there immediately. But nobody knows. Log kya samajhte? This all are siddhis. Devta prasanna karne padenge, Himalaya jana padega, tapasya karni padegi, tab jaakar ye sab power prapt hote hain. This is what I also used to understand, ke shayad ye sab shaktiyan hoti hai. But what I realized, all powers are natural powers. We are already gifted. We are inherited. But by certain small techniques, we have to activate these powers. So one is universal healing power, Reiki. Earlier, I was using a lot of fasting in my practice, like 45 days, 50 days, 90 days, because fasting is very popular in America and by Dr. Shelton. I was following Dr. Shelton also. But why we do fasting? Because we have to conserve the energy. So what I realized that we don't need fasting now, because the direct vital force, the vital energy, we can get through the Reiki and the prana energy through the universe, and that is called universal healing energy Reiki. So Reiki means vital force. Reiki means circulation. Reiki means regeneration. So therefore, wherever we give Reiki, immediately the energy changes. I will just give an example. One of my recently a person came to me. He had gangrene. You know that gangrene is a dead tissue, and normally in medical science it cannot be revived. It cannot be regenerated again. So even I also believe like this, because even being in naturopathy also, what I thought, thoda mushkil hai, thoda difficult hoga. I also thought like this. But while applying Reiki to that part, I have seen that within 45 days to 50 days, that person, again the circulation started to that part and the part regenerated, and that gangrenous part has become normal again. And my friend will show you gangrene ka ek chitra batayega zara Umesh ji. So, a dead tissue, this was the dead tissue. So after 45 days, he became all right. He is from Faridabad, and now he is totally normal person. So I could not believe that Reiki is such a powerful healing tool that it immediately penetrates in the ultimate atom of a cell. And that cell, then it starts regenerating. So body is waiting for vital force, and Reiki is a greater force which can be supplied, and it does not need any knowledge. You know, the more ignorant we are, the more illiterate we are, the better healer we will be. This is the biggest greatness of the Reiki. And the Reiki only cannot be given on the human being. It can be given even to the plants also. A lot of my Reiki masters, they are using on the agricultural land, and they are getting 40 to 50% extra yield just because they are giving Reiki to the seeds and they are giving Reiki to the plants. Because everybody knows very well that plants respond to your vibrations and love more, and they too have also feelings inside. So we have power to communicate with the plants in the Reiki. Then we have power to heal animals. You'll be surprised that a lot of, earlier, whenever we go to, when we were going on the morning walk, if we saw any bird or something, they are lying down, they got injured, we could not help them, because hum kya karein, hum to kuch nahi kar sakte. But now, hum usko utha ke leke aate hain, hamare ghar mein hamare servants bhi hain, wo bhi Reiki jante hain, and when they give Reiki, after a few hours, we find that we would go wahan se, wo chale gaye wahan se. Agar Reiki nahi jante, to shayad hum us animals ko bilkul help nahi kar paate. Aaj ek kida makoda, koi bhi ek cockroach bhi agar injure ho jaye na, normally you will not be able to help them. But if you know Reiki, at least you will be healing animals. So, aapki jo compassion hai, aapki jo daya hai, wo jyada aur expand hui. Aur Reiki mein aur jo sabse bada jo fayda hota hai, that is, You have power to influence non-living also. You will be surprised. Dr. Emoto ka aapne abhi experiment ke baare mein baat kiya tha. If we just tank the water, water immediately changes within friction of second. Dr. Emoto has showed that. So when I went to Japan to meet Dr. Emoto, for 9 days I kept my paratha chapati which I took with me. 9 days tak maine usko fresh bana ke rakha just by charging with the Reiki. Normally, after 3 days, it has to ferment, no? But see, why one cheese remain for longer time? If the energy level are high, then it will remain for longer time. If the energy level goes down, it automatically ferments. So, what is the Reiki? Reiki is a direct prana energy supplying to living or non-living. So, therefore, apart from Reiki, one more thing which I am emphasizing more in my practice, that is subconscious mind. Dr. Hegde has said placebo effect of the medicine. I have written one book also, The Miraculous Power of Subconscious Mind. How, see, there may be good Reiki, there may be yoga, there may be meditation, there may be lot of things, good food also. But your subconscious mind is such a greatest power, it can create disease, it can create health. He is the governor of your life. So if you understand your subconscious, you can master your whole life and your destiny even. So therefore, I suggest that there are so many areas are still unrecognized. One is past life also, as she said, that lot of problems are connected with the past life. I also have found, because one of my lady, she was having joint pain. After taking into past life, when she came back, she was absolutely all right. Even I could not believe how it can happen. But so lot of causes is still to be studied. So what I suggest all my friends and all, even Life Positive Foundation and so many all big people are sitting here, that please, we must have such an organization or institution and hospital or institution where all these kinds of research, which is lacking in the India so far, this research on special occults and energy sciences is to be developed very soon. So I thank you very much for giving me opportunity to talk to you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Sharmaji, for having brought in the concept of pranic healing, energy. We all knew very well, even now we have understood in physics, there had been a discussion in the morning. I happen to be son of a physics professor. Obviously, I would have that in my genes. Genes, not Jeans. Okay? We talk of light, the visible spectrum, 400 to 700 nanometers. And the belief was, yes, light is only this much. But then later on, we came to know that light is a form of energy. And this energy goes beyond 400, I mean beyond 700 and also below 400. And we had to look for that, and that's the way we got to know of the ultraviolet and the infrared. And to look into that, we needed to have instruments which could show us, yes, light exists beyond the visible range also. On a similar way, I think the energy that is there needs to be understood. So one instrument possibly that we have is probably Reiki or the pranic healing. You do have, if you look into the ancient scriptures again, I think we had the mantras which has to be chanted, the sound energy possibly was able to heal things. We have talked of people who just by a mere look were able to bring about changes. Touch, the sparsh, that's possibly we call them as Nayan Diksha, Sparsh Diksha and things like that. There are changes that are brought in, which means there is an energy that definitely brings in. As he was able to keep the chapatis alive for 9 days in Japan when he went, I think if you look into Ramayana, probably we know Shabri was able to keep the veil for Ram. Probably she knew this pranic healing. We do not know. We haven't understood. But there are cases, there are evidences that are available, maybe that we have certain blocks. We are like horses with blinkers. I know only this. I don't want to go beyond. Probably that's what is happening here. I think this probably has brought in a synergy where beyond Ayurveda and the naturopathy, we also have the universal energy which could. That's what I said, yad bhavam tad bhavati, as you look into this, as you think, so you become. That's it. In fact, that's what they normally say. Butterfly from a caterpillar through the pupal stage comes out as a beautiful butterfly. It's only the thought process. It's able to break. Again, we have evidence in the scripture when Hanuman came and stood in front of the Indian Ocean, he was wondering how he would be able to cross the ocean and go to Lanka. It was others who had to tell him, Hanuman, you have the potency, you have the power. Somebody had to tell you. Then he realized, and that's the way we went in. Into these three aspects of the so-called complementary and alternate medicine, it brings us into something which is very important for life, and probably that is the Veda, the Ayurveda. What had been the impact of Ayurveda on our health and the current status? I think we do not require anybody else other than Pratap Chauhan to tell us.
I've got a warning.
Yes.
Time is limited.
Yeah. So,
give us in the form of a capsule.
Yes, I will. Aspects of health. In Ayurveda, of course, as Dr. Hegde said, and I agree with him, Ayurveda is actually the mother science. Many of us don't know about Ayurveda. We just know Ayurveda is some herbs or some kind of home remedies. The word itself tells you the meaning, Ayurveda. Veda means knowledge, and Ayur is very nicely defined in Charak Samhita. Sharira Indriya Sattvatma Sanyog is Ayu. It's a combination of body, mind, senses and soul, which actually is this human system. This human system has a body, we all have senses, we have mind, and we also have a soul. So it's a knowledge about human beings. We all have been hearing very great talks this morning, and it looks like nobody should be sick on this earth. But when we look outside in the world, the results are totally opposite. You know, every year disease is increasing. Diabetes in India is increasing. So definitely there is something wrong, which is wrong with us. You know, we don't understand how to be healthy. What is health? Maybe we don't understand what is health. In Ayurveda, again, a very nice definition. Even the word swastha. If you just look at the word swastha, if you want to be healthy, it's very important to understand what is the meaning of word swastha. Swa plus stha. To be situated in yourself. This is very, very important. Once you are situated in yourself, you will know the ways to become healthy. You will know how to heal your diseases, whether it is at physical level or at psychological level or it is at energy level. This whole description will be automatically rejuvenated or regenerated inside you. It's like when you want to drive a car, you have to sit in the driver's seat. But most of us are now trying to drive this car by sitting outside, not in back seat or even sometimes outside actually. We're just pushing it. So we are not inside, we are not situated inside. So this is what Ayurveda very simple way explains. And this is given a very nice definition also, like samadosha, samagani, samadhatu, malakriya, prasanna atmendriya mana, swastha itta vidhiyate. At physical level, we have to understand our physical bodies. What are we made up of? We talked about five elements. What are these five elements? We all hear earth, water, fire, air, space. But if I ask you, what does it mean? We don't know. That means we are not swastha, we are not situated in ourselves. Does it mean there is mud in the body, earth, there is water, lake of water, some air is blowing, or there is a fire inside? What does it actually mean? We don't understand. So we have to really understand the meaning of these words. What is fire means? What is fire? There is fire in the body. But it is a metaphoric word, we have temperature in the body, we have the digestive fire. We have also other types of chemicals which are fire element. We have the physical earth, which is the heavy, the solid part of the body. And that's where Ayurveda comes into picture. The first thing Ayurveda tells is, if you want to be healthy, you have to understand yourself. You have to understand what is your body type. Each one of us is unique. This is very important principle of Ayurveda. That's why sometimes even we healers or doctors, we may have healed like one gangrene case, but the another person comes with the same case, we're trying to apply the same principle, it doesn't work. Because everybody is unique. And this has to be understood by the patient first of all. In Ayurveda we give this differentiation of Vata type body, Pitta type body, Kapha type body. And we have our characteristics, This is what I mean by being situated in the driver's seat. I have to understand what is my body type, what food is good for me, what food is not good for me, what type of lifestyle, what is my attitude, what is my mental attitude, So this is where Ayurveda explains. Ayurveda also explains very beautifully what is the root cause of our disease, which sometimes we don't really try to look into. We're looking into many healing practices, we're looking into many types of treatment, but what is the root cause? Why do we even become sick? Why do the animals don't become sick? Why do we not have any hospitals in the forest? Of course, now animals, when we bring them into our houses, they also become sick. I was visiting one friend in London and she was injecting the cat. I asked, what are you doing? She said, the cat has diabetes. So I'm putting insulin injection. Because when we bring them into our system, they also become, now we have like veterinary doctors and dog doctors, very special and very expensive also. So the problem is the moment we understand what is the cause of disease, then we can start healing. And in Ayurveda, a very beautiful description is given. They have not talked about any virus, bacteria or anything, even not Vata Pitta Kapha. The first cause of disease is called Pragya Parada. Misuse of intelligence, very beautifully written. We become sick because we don't use our intelligence. I hope we all have intelligence, right? Anybody without intelligence?
We think so.
But we don't use it. That's the problem. You know, you might see many people, they have burning sensation, which is called hyperacidity, very common problem. But the first thing in the morning, they will drink a chai. This is called Pragya Parada. Lot of things we do every day, Pragya Parada, misuse of intelligence. So Ayurveda explains that how we can fix this problem, because this problem is caused due to too much rajas and tamas in the mind. So that's why the treatment, when they talk about treatment, they talk about three types of treatment in Ayurveda. And in fact, all these treatments that you're hearing are there in Ayurveda. They have, but now even Ayurvedic doctors don't know about this. There are three types of treatment they have described. Yukti Vipashraya is the physical part where you have all the panchakarma or the food medicine or the naturopathy or the yogic therapy or the breathing therapy or the different kind of, you know, which will work at your physical level to fix your physical problems. We have Sattva Vajat Chikitsa. Very nice. Sattva means the guna in the mind that makes the mind healthy. So Sattva Vajat Chikitsa is also there, which also involves a lot of, you know, different practices. It also involves hypnotherapy. It also involves motivation, inspiration, placebo. All these techniques are there. And we have also Dev Vipashara Chikitsa, which are the spiritual treatments, where we talk of the energy that we have inside, the healing energy, and we talk of the cosmic energy or the God energy. Because ultimately, we have to believe and we have to understand that there is something beyond medicines, there is something beyond the techniques that we are using, which is the healing factor in this body. And of course, this is the divine energy. So that is what is called in Ayurveda, the Dev Vipashara Chikitsa. And they talk about Mantra Chikitsa, they talk about Yajnas, they talk about different types of treatments. So I think the need today is to understand, first of all, whenever you have any sickness, any disease, please make sure to first ask a question, what is the cause of this problem? Why I am having diabetes? Why I have a headache? You will find some answer if you start asking this question. Don't go to the doctor. Our problem is that we take this body, which is my body, which I understand the best. I take this to the doctor, which the doctor actually don't know anything about me. He has met me for the first time. He'll ask you some few questions and prescribe medicine. And those few questions also you are answering, you know. You are telling him about yourself. He doesn't know anything about yourself. So he's prescribing you medicine. So you can be your best doctor if you understand your body type, you understand your nature. Many people will come and tell me, you know, each time I eat this special food, I get a headache, you know. So he's telling me what is wrong, you know. But they don't know. But we charge the consultation. And we tell them, okay, you stop this and take this. So in Ayurveda, there is a beautiful shloka about the Priyojan. Swasthasya swasthya rakshana maturasya vikar prashmanche. This is a very nice knowledge system which was created to keep people healthy. Not only the sick people, but also the healthy people. Swasthasya swasthya rakshana. So it's not only about sick people. If you want to talk about the second part, aturasya vikar prashmanche, I think Ayurveda is such a detailed medical system. It has 8 branches, you know. Kaya chikitsa, pediatrics, which is medicine, internal medicine. It has pediatrics, it has surgery, shalya chikitsa, it has shalakya, eyes and ENT. It has also has psychotherapy, it has also psychiatric, and also rejuvenation. It has also a special branch of rejuvenation. The only medical system in the world which talks about, you know, rehabilitation, rejuvenation and all that. So it's a complete medical system. We have a very short time. I can't really go into much detail. But I really believe very strongly that if we bring about an integration into medical system, where I would like to also mention, although I'm an Ayurvedic doctor, but I not very strongly criticize modern medicine also, or Western medicine, whatever it is. You know, there are situations where we do need some kind of intervention or some kind of, you know, immediate attention, for which our Western medicine is very nice. So I believe that the future of medicine will be integration, and we all have to come to that common platform where we can communicate with each other, we can talk to each other without, you know, having any ego problems and without that caste problem that Dr. Hegde mentioned. We should not feel that I am of this caste and you are of that caste. And this is already happening. And in last few months or last couple of years, I have been meeting a lot of modern medical doctors who are very much willing to work with us. I will only give one last suggestion to all of us here in this forum, that we sometimes talk a lot, you know, I can do this, I healed this, I did this, but please document everything. Please keep records, because we need to show it to the world. Because when it comes to people asking us that, can you show me, how did you do it, what did you do, that's where we don't have anything to show. So then it looks like, you know, just some, not really. So this is what we are doing in Jiva now. We have the largest database of Ayurvedic patients. Last 18 months we had 6.5 lakh patients, which are all documented, and we are doing now analysis on that, and we are trying to publish some research papers based on that. My goal, first of all, in this project is to validate what is written in our Shastra is correct, completely correct, and I can prove it through my database. So I would just like to end it here, because we have short of time. Thank you very much. Namaskar.
Thank you, Dr. Pradap. It has been a nice thing. He brought in the concept of personalized medicine, which is probably growing up today, because every individual is unique and he has to be treated. I think it's Ayurveda which had brought in this concept, and then even today they treat the same way. Whereas for me, if I have paracetamol, it treats all fevers. That's a concept that you have probably in the so-called Western medicine. But then here it is, individualized medicine that needs to be given, and it goes into the root cause of a disease, while in Western medicine it only treats, it literally sees to it that you don't feel, it doesn't treat the root cause of it. That is the basic problem that we have. Now, having known about these things, it becomes important for us to have an idea as to how holistically I'll be able to look into this. Do we have any place in India where we look into the holistic approach of a person when he comes with some sickness? I think it's only Dr. Tully who would be able to tell us about this. I would request Dr. Tully to enlighten us on that.
And I think it's the best way to celebrate this 20th landmark anniversary of Life Positive to address to the burning issue of the day. And after a scintillating and evergreen talk by Dr. B.M. Hegde, my predecessors have laid a very sound foundation for all of us to know, and know the strengths of each and the respective systems of medicine. But now the issue is, of course, they say prevention is the best cure. And I'm sorry, this has got corrupted. It's Sarve Bhavantu Sukhina, Sarve Santu Niramaya, Me Bhadrani Pashyantu, Ma Kashichat Cha Bhag Bhaveta. That we pray from that all beings be healthy, may all beings have the well-being of all in mind, and may nobody suffer in any way. But human beings are human beings, and they only think of a doctor when they suffer from a sickness. I wish nobody suffered from any sickness or any disease, because that's the only way that we can really bring out the best in us. However, since I took to the medical profession, I get to handle the sickness of the people and the challenges to at least those. I tell everybody, I say, you have to take blame for your own sickness. I know nobody wants to fall sick, but knowingly or unknowingly, consciously or subconsciously, we do certain mistakes. As a result, we suffer in our health, and when the health goes back and when they come to a doctor, it is the onerous duty of the doctor to get their best to restore, not only remove the sickness, but to restore what we call positive health and total wellness, body, mind and spirit. And with that in advance and that in mind, a few friends, we got together and established this society called the Society for Holistic Advancement of Medicine, and it abbreviated into this dramatic word, SOHAB. Now this society is dedicated to total health and positive wellness, body, mind and spirit, by a synergy of the evidence-based science, I say the knowledge of modern medicine, with the time-tested art and the wisdom of various drug-free modalities of the officially recognized traditional systems of health. When we say complementary alternate medicine, it's like complementing, as if the mainstream medicine, the modern medicine has become the mainstream medicine, and now complementing it with so-called the alternate systems of various other systems, and many of them like the systems of Ayush, which are officially recognized, means they have withstood the scientific trial of time and are evidence-based. So now is to put them all together so that we can bring out the best in the human being. So we say this approach, where we complement the modern medicine. See, our healthcare infrastructure in our country is based upon the modern system of medicine. 90% of the budget spent on the medical healthcare, and about 10% is barely allotted to the Ayush. But the pity is that the Ayush department is not even able to spend that 10% of the money. Every year, that unspent money is carried forward. So there is some gap, and we have to address to that. Now, I am a product of the armed forces, prestigious Armed Forces Medical College, and I was training in the armed forces in military medicine, which besides the general medicine trains us to take care of the people under the most adverse conditions, at the high altitude or in the deepest of the jungles, or in the submerged submarines, or the aircrafts which take off into the space within minutes of seconds, posing great challenges on our physiology, and yet they can only achieve that if they remain drug-free. My job as a doctor, because after my graduation, I first was trained in aviation medicine and then in sports medicine, and I realized to get the best in the both, no drug can help me. If I have to bring out the best in my client, whether he is a sportsman or he is an air warrior, he can do it only if I give him no drugs. And today I realize if I can be healthy, is only if I take no drugs. So it's very important. Chardiya kala. So, and this approach where we incorporate the best of all the systems of medicine, it also helps us to overcome the inherent deficiencies of the various systems of medicine. This is called holistic medicine. It's a board certified specialty in the US for over 20 years. But in our country, to talk about it is a sin. Still, I will try to put forward in the next few minutes. First, why we need this, when we have such a, as we say, a great infrastructure based upon the allopathic system of medicine, why we need to go beyond it, and what it is. What it is, how we can achieve this integration, and what are its benefits, especially its efficacy in the various incurable sicknesses, and that's the objective, and this is how in steps I will go around. You know, by 1978, the medical scientists all over the world came to a confidence that they thought that they could deliver health to all in the next 20 odd years, and they kept 2000 AD as a mission to give health for everyone. But much before the due date, they realized that this system could not work. And an audit revealed that essentially this system failed because it was essentially based on the system of modern medicine, which is not accessible and also not acceptable to most of the people in the world. Besides the costs of this system of medicine, it causes tremendous harm simultaneously, and it addresses only to the physical needs of the person. And they realized that if this was indigenized, and this, if it was integrated with the existing wisdom, we could bring out much better, and the 1986 World Health Assembly promulgated that the definition of health, which meant only physical, mental and social well-being, grossly lacked in its definition and suggested spiritual well-being of the persons. Now this is just to show to you that no doubt India is stated to be a poor country. We can only afford so much, and which is said about our budget spares only about 1% of its GDP for health. But even the countries who spend about 30 or 40 times more have not been able to get health, or people in those countries are not satisfied with their health care. So it does not mean even if from 1% we raise our health care budget to 5%, we are not going to be able to solve the problem, as long as it remains dependent on the modern system of medicine. Then it is very iatrogenesis. In the US, it is determined that besides the harmful unnecessary surgery and medication errors, etc., in hospital, this is the third most cause of death. Iatrogenesis is the third most common cause of direct death, and they also compiled that if the other indirect effects due to which the death is affected are brought in, it will be probably killing more people than any single sickness. It was in fact brought out that 35 to 40% of diagnosis of cause of death were incorrect on autopsy. That means nearly half the people who were, for whatever they treated, by best of the medical procedures available, more than about 40% of them were being treated wrongly. A lot about modern medicine, it's creating lots of problems. Now, there is evidence, these are official figures, that in the last three decades, when the modern medicine has peaked, we've got world-class healthcare infrastructure in our country. India has today perhaps the world's largest number of world-class hospitals, and a huge number of people, even from other countries, are coming to our country to avail of this healthcare that we have. So while the technology has boomed, it is brought out that there are incidence of all common diseases has gone up four times in the last three decades, again revealing that we cannot remain dependent exclusively on this system. At the same time, while the antibiotics came and impressed and established modern medicine. Now there is a problem of drug antibiotic resistance is becoming a very grave. At the same time, viruses just do not listen, and we don't have anything on the horizon that can control these viral infections. And of course, it's so expensive that the government of India's statistics reveal that 4% of Indian population falls below. Now I know, sir, I can stop any time you tell me, but the job will be left incomplete. 4% of the Indian population falls below poverty line. And here is a guideline from Albert Einstein: unless we realize our limits, we will never go beyond. This is what, as I said, WHO in 1945 definition, which still prevails and governs the medical profession, is that health is a state of complete physical, mental and social well-being, whereas the 1986 recommendation, even after 30 years, that spiritual dimension should also be added, has not been accepted by the medical authorities the world over. At the same time, our national health, the WHO has endorsed, and our national health policy has promulgated, that there should be an optimum integration of all the recognized systems of medicine, which of course, besides the Ayush systems, they have given recognition to the system of acupuncture and hypnotherapy by trained, qualified medical doctors. While we proceed, we should not forget that there is a whole ancient wisdom, we should not ignore that, which is brought out in the Charaka Samhita, that which always stated the objective of medicine is not merely a disease-free living, but a firm establishment of full positive health. And it also teaches us that life, human being, is not just the physical body, but it's a combination of the body, the senses, the mind and the atma, and they all have to move together. And in fact, human being is stated to be a spiritual being on a physical journey. This physical body is just the appearance of, in reality, who I am, and it is very important. And if my spirit is healthy, my mind will take all healthy decisions, and my physical body would enjoy. And this all happens through the mind, that my physical body is regulated. Also, we have to remember that our health is a product of three factors. That's the host, the human being, the agents, the microbes. Sometimes I think we give too much importance to sterilization. We are designed to live in synergy with our environment. As it is said, that the people who live in the forest do not suffer from infections, but the most serious infections come from the operation theatres of the hospitals. And of course, the role of our environment, this environment is being highly polluted. Now, when we said that human being is a spiritual being, the spirit is that consciousness, that energy, as it runs through the human being, it creates a glow. What has been across civilizations has been recognized to be the glow. This was detected about 100 years ago in the form of Carolian photography, that each human being really has a glow. It has a great diagnostic facility which can help us not only know ourselves, but probably forecast our diseases much ahead of the time. A disease to manifest in its physical body takes many times, even more than a decade, then it happens in our energy body. So this is a very useful tool. Of course, no scientific work has been done, but there is no doubt about it, that not only it tells us about our aura, that's our personality, our traits. Many people, they do not even know themselves. So it helps us to understand who I am. And then the state of my various chakras. These chakras are the energy centers. As I say, as the energy flows through me, it is modified. It manifests as a different color for the different seven major chakra systems. Why this color changes? Because the energy remaining the same, but the energy needs of my brain, of my throat, of my heart, of my digestive system, or of my sexual glands, are different. So that energy, as the frequency changes, these colors of these chakras change, and it tells me where is the weakness, where is the deficiency, where is the excess, and how through various yogic and Ayurvedic techniques I can regulate, I can balance and harmonize. Has been described that there are 84,000 nadis in our yogic science and the chakras. But the each chakra is related to the most important endocrine systems and to the, as the Ida Pingla is the autonomic, the sympathetic and the parasympathetic nervous systems. So if we go into this, there is a very close relation, and this can be beautifully used. No doubt the yoga has gone to the world, but what we need is the quality control in yoga. There are so many brands and everybody brings out his own home brand. Similarly, the Chinese, as in the Ida and the Pingla, the Chinese also developed this concept of the yin and the yang and developed a system, and they also believed in tapping the energy, the prana. We have heard of a discourse on Reiki, naturopathy. The purpose of yoga is nothing but becoming one with this universal energy, and this helps us. But there's a, I must bring to you to this system of acupuncture, which was like in a wartime, many inventions happened. A soldier got stuck with this arrow, and his shoulder, which was stuck for a long time, got opened and started working. It made the research workers, the healing physicians of the era, to bring them together and say, if this point has some, there must be other similarly points, and they started scanning everybody and brought a system of what is called acupuncture meridians. And this system of acupuncture, the Chinese have developed it in recent times and showed how efficacious it was. Even major surgery could be done under effect of few needles. That way back in 1982, this was recognized in officially a scientific endorsement by the World Health Organization. And as Dr. Salila Tiwari was telling, that acupressure and its various forms, and Sujok acupuncture and auriculotherapy, radiculotherapy, etc., these have come up. You know, it may be just a cartoon, but sometimes it can be really very useful in early control of a sickness. Then, as Hippocrates said, let thy food be thy medicine. And of course, today organic food, the role of the mind, the conscious, the subconscious mind. It is not my subconscious mind, it is the subconscious mind which is regulating, which tells me now wake up and go to bed, which tells me now it's time to eat, which sends me to the loo when it needs to be evacuated. So it's all the time it is regulating, and also the diseases are controlled at this level. So that's where we need to understand the system. It is far more effective than the conventional psychotherapy. That, you know, it's hundreds of times more efficacious. And then whatever you do, yes sir, I will stop here. Thank you very much. I put in a lot of effort to bring out to how to bring this integration. But I will still take time from the chairman to explain this one slide. Now, holistic medicine means is address the human being as a whole. That is physical, mental, emotional and spiritual aspects of the human being simultaneously. I have compared it to the white light. You know, the sunlight, they say there is a God or not, but if there is no sun, there will be no life on the planet. And this sunlight comprises of the seven colors, which is the different systems of medicine. The most important is the lifestyle. And yoga and exercise, the public health, the hygiene, and of course, the nature cure. It is through these modalities. Acupuncture is nothing but an accelerated yoga. As again Dr. Salila Tiwari tried to bring out, like acupressure itself, which is of course a lay practice, acupuncture, I am asked this question many times, what is the difference between acupuncture and acupressure? I say, well, the difference between a doctor and a nurse. A doctor can have various levels of his skills. So this is how, and the various it combines, but in holistic medicine, we combine modern medicine, we complement modern medicine with a various drug-free. That there is no conflict, that there are no drug interactions,
And as Hippocrates said, primum non nocere. First make sure no harm. There is no system of medicine, as Dr. Hegde said, there is no medicine in the world which is harmless. So, let us pick up the drug-free modalities of the various systems, and that itself can help us to cure. Even Hippocrates recognized that there is a natural healing force within each one of us, which is the greatest force in getting well. And that's the power, and I have my compiled data, etc., to show that it is absolutely scientific, it causes no harm, and it expands our scope to cure any disease. In fact, it handles all the diseases of a human being concurrently. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Tully. I had to be the CIC, as Dr. Hegde said in the morning, right? To bring in certain amount of orderliness, because we are running short of time, that's one thing. But then beautifully, Dr. Tully had brought in this concept of holistic approach. It's asking somebody, are your eyes important or your ears important? I think we need to understand the various systems of medicine that we have today, as of today, what we have probably seen or heard or understood are like different parts of the body. And if you like to ask which part of the body is important, it would be very difficult for me at least to say that this is the most important. No, all are equally important. They have their own respective functions to perform. Without these, it will be very difficult. And that's the concept of holistic approach, which he has beautifully brought in and then told us. And all of us do know, we always carry an aura around us. He did touch upon that. Each one of us do have an aura, radiations, energy that goes out of our body. And that can be easily done. The Kirlian photography is one which had shown this. And there are occasions where even inanimate objects have got their feelings and senses. We do have reports available today. So that shows that what probably we know is so little. What we are to know is so much. Probably we need to have the proper instruments to fathom the unseen things, the unknown things. And if we can bring in all of them together, I think probably there would be an integration, a holistic approach, and we might be able to go well. That is why probably in the ancient scriptures it was mentioned, Vasudhaiva Kutum Pakam. We are together. So I would not call naturopathy is the supreme, or acupuncture or acupressure is the best. No, all are equally important. A time has come where probably we need to understand we are living in a family, and each member of the family is important. There's no point in fighting between the members of the family. And therefore, a stage has come where probably we have come together, we have started understanding each other. We were islands. We were probably people with glass walls around them. 20 years it had taken us, probably, to break this. We have come out of the teens. Life positive has become a total adult. Become highly responsible citizen. And therefore, I think this is the time where possibly we come together, we share our thoughts together, we join hands together to have a positive society, a positive society where life is positive, our thoughts are positive, our deeds are positive, and everything is positive. Thank you so much.